All right, so today I'm going to explain how you can store patches from your Millennium amplifier onto your computer. And you'll only need a handful of things. I'm assuming since you're watching this video that you have either a JM150 or 250, and the procedure for both amplifiers is exactly the same because both store patches on an EEPROM, which is an electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory. You need some sort of MIDI interface to get data, that data being what are called system exclusive or sysx messages between the amplifier and the computer. So when the Johnson came out, the MPU-401, which was developed by Roland, was a standard included with a lot of sound cards on many computers. It could also be used as a joystick port. So chances are your machine probably doesn't have that at this point, but or you're not going to have this cable that you see pictured, but a USB to MIDI interface will work. So in this example, I'm using M-Audio's MIDI Sport 4x4. You can use virtually any commercial MIDI interface, and I'm sure it'll be fine. And they work fine for patch dumps, but never ever attempt to update the amplifier's operating software using a USB to MIDI interface, and I'll talk about why a little bit at the end of the video. So this is a standard MIDI cable, which is a 5-pin DIN connector, and although there's only one pictured, you're going to need two of them to actually perform the patch dumps. So the last thing you'll need is a patch librarian software or a sysx editor. I recommend Johnson's software directly from the site, but there is one problem, and that's depending on how new or old your computer is, you might not be able to get it to work. So in this example, I happen to have still sitting around an older machine which uses Windows XP. I couldn't get it to operate on Windows 7, even in backwards compatibility mode. This is also why, unfortunately, I wasn't able to take real live screenshots. So when I'm using the software, you're gonna see videos taken from my iPhone, unfortunately, but I think you'll still get the picture. So visit the link you see in the browser window. And again, whether you're using the 150 or the 250, the updater will work the same for patch dumps. So download the JM150 version 1.14, or if you're on Mac, you can grab any of the other ones, and then unzip the files. So if you're going to use a third-party patch librarian, I'm not going to be able to directly help you unless I happen to know the software you're using, but because there's so many of them, I'm kind of doubting it. So if you have specific questions about your librarian or editor, you should consult their documentation. So once you've downloaded the file, extract into a folder, run the setup program, double-clicking the icon, and then you'll be prompted for directories and standard install stuff. And then once that's done, you can click OK and then run the actual updater by clicking the icon. That's the software. So then the next thing we need to do is make physical connections from the MIDI in and out of the interface to the actual MIDI in and out of the amplifier. So we'll start with output from the interface, and I'm choosing port A, and we'll need to connect the MIDI out of the interface to the MIDI input on the back of the amplifier. Then the other thing that we need to do is we need to ensure that the software knows which actual port is being used. So you can see highlighted in blue, I've selected MIDI Sport 4x4 input A, which is where the physical connection was made. Then next, we need to plug the MIDI input. Again, I chose A from the interface to the MIDI out through of the amplifier. So, and anytime you make these connections, just remember input of one device goes to output of the other, and vice versa. Then, as we did before, go into the updater software and select the appropriate output port that you're using. Again, you can see my selection highlighted in blue, which was the MIDI Sport 4x4 output A. So Bosley patch, which is user patch 71, is the patch I'm going to work with. And no matter what librarian or editor you use, you need to ensure that the software and the amp are going to communicate on the same sysx channel. So start out by clicking the utility button in the upper right corner of the amp, which you'll see here. Then using the page knob, scroll until you're on page 6. Check the sysx channel, which is in the center there. And in this case, it's channel 1. Then you need to look at the updater software in the lower left corner where it says sysx channel and ensure that what your amp said was the channel matches with the software, otherwise they won't communicate. So then, in the software updater, I click get one preset. You select the patch number you want to get, which is 71 in this case, and OK when you finally select it. Then it's communicating, a MIDI icon comes up, and then a prompt to name the path, the patch, which defaults to what the patch name is. You hit save, and it's stored. So you'll also see indications on the USB interface that the Johnson is transmitting the data to the computer. So voila, your patch is stored on your computer. So if you're going to use a third-party patch librarian or editor, you need to manually send the patch dump to that software. So if you've gotten out of the utility pages, hit the utility button again, scroll using the page knob to page 8, and then turn the one knob, which is yes on the display, and that actually sends the patch to your librarian. The Johnson will respond by letting you know that sysx information is being transferred, so it's a sending preset dump. So if you want to dump a preset back into the amplifier from the computer using the updater, click dump one preset, select its destination, which I'm going to pick 72, and then hit OK. And the amplifier is going to tell you where it's storing what it's receiving. So storing two presets, 72 via MIDI, and that's coming from the computer. And the MIDI interface will also indicate when the patch is being sent to the amp on the MIDI out. Then the Johnson sends a handshake back and tells the computer it got the information. So there you have it. There is patch 72. It's a clone of patch 71 that's come through the computer. And as a note, you can do this with any patch. So you may have noticed that there was a few other options for getting and dumping data, and namely the get bulk data and dump bulk data options. And what these do is these store or replace every single patch in the system all at once. And it takes obviously longer than an individual patch dump, but it allows you to back up all of your patches at once or upload an entire set of patches from the computer. It's a really nice feature, but if you store bulk data, you lose the capability to reopen each patch individually. So this also brings me to the next point, which I grazed at the beginning, and it's the update OS button. Don't use it unless you have the MP401 compatible input and output on your computer. And this is my warning, don't do it. The system update procedure that the software uses was originally designed to work with the MPU-401's protocols, and USB to MIDI is slightly different. I've actually had a couple of emails now about people who tried to use the USB interface. It gets to about 99% into the process of updating their operating system on their amplifier, and then it freezes. Okay. There's something in the communication format that doesn't allow that final ending message between the computer and the amp. So when these people shut their units down, there's essentially incomplete operating system, so the amplifier won't turn on because the it physically turns on, there's electricity, but the software won't boot because the OS is incomplete. And there's really no bringing it back short of actually replacing the EEPROM, which is not likely that most people are going to be able to do that. And then there's another trick where you can disconnect a single tiny surface mount soldered pin. And disconnecting this one pin forces the unit to boot from a different area of memory. It's not an amateur thing. It's not something that most people are going to be able to do or going to want to even try to do. And just as a side note, if this ever happens to you, I do actually have a bunch of blank EEPROMs that are the EEPROMs that were used in these amps, but they aren't flashed. So you would have to find somebody with an EEPROM programmer, and I no longer have access to one. Okay, best of luck. If you have additional questions, the manual is downloadable under the same link that the updater software is at, or if you have some question that the manual doesn't directly address or you're not sure how to deal with it, you can feel free to contact me through my website, which is www.bosleymusic.com.